Nintendo just released their new financial results. Let's take a look at what games are doing well. Alright, Animal Crossing did phenomenal. Mario 3D All-Stars did well too. The Switch as a whole is doing incredible. Let's see how Mario Kart 8 Deluxe... Yeah, we're never getting a Mario Kart 9. Mario Kart is one of my favorite franchises of all time, and I want a Mario Kart 9 as much as the rest of you guys. But the chances of Nintendo putting out a Mario Kart 9 while Mario Kart 8 Deluxe is still doing so well, the chances are just minuscule, they're not there. And that sucks, because new Mario Kart courses are some of my absolute favorite parts of being a Nintendo fan. I don't know why, like, Nintendo just goes so crazy with Mario Kart, but for this series in particular, they just go so hard in the creative department. It's just absolutely absurd some of the cool ideas they come up with. And especially with Mario Kart 8 and 8 Deluxe's kind of introduction to Nintendo courses that are outside of the Mario Kart realm, such as, I don't know, Big Blue or Animal Crossing or the Splatoon Battle Course, it seems like now more than ever there is so much potential for Mario Kart courses. So instead of waiting for Nintendo, I made some of my own. Me and my sister made a few Mario Kart courses using Mario Kart Live Home Circuit, and these are courses that I want to see in Mario Kart 9. Honestly, they came out a lot better than I was expecting, and overall, I really can't wait to show you guys these courses we made. However, quickly before getting into that, I have a word from this video's sponsor. This video is brought to you by Skyforge. Skyforge is a sci-fi action MMO set in the breathtaking world of Alien. Play as an immortal with amazing celestial powers and team up with other players around the world to explore and defend this massively and constantly evolving universe. This game is massive and has 18 different classes that you can instantly switch between, such as the Grove Walker, Sound Weaver, and Firestarter. Skyforge is free to download and perfectly optimized for the Switch. It works great in handheld mode, and you don't even need a Nintendo Switch Online membership in order to play the game. The game just launched, and if you play now, you can get the Cyber Warrior costume, Halo of Vows, Glowing God Eyes, Wings of Vows, and 2 God Tattoos for a limited time. You can also purchase Founders Packs on the Nintendo eShop, which include awesome content like class unlocks, Founders titles, and cosmetics. The Switch-exclusive callsign NX Wings even look like Neon Joy-Con, which is pretty cool. Skyforge is free to download now, from the Nintendo eShop on your Nintendo Switch, so click the link in the description to get started today, complete the tutorial to unlock free limited time launch gifts, and thanks to Skyforge for sponsoring this video. With that out of the way, let's jump into the first track on this list, which is a Hoenn track from Pokemon. Remember how I talked about more Nintendo tracks? Yeah, well, this would be one of them. Pokemon Sapphire is probably, like, the most important game to me that I've ever played. Like, it means so much to me. I love that game. It has a huge nostalgic value to me, and Hoenn is an absolutely remarkable region. I think it's probably the best overall Pokemon region to date, but obviously I'm a little bit biased. Regardless, take a look at the Hoenn track. It starts out in Oldale Town for Lap 1. You can see the Poke Center and Pokemart in the background. We put the actual Game Boy here because, I don't know, I thought it would be a nice little distraction, I guess. And there are a couple of Pokemon sneaking around. The next town here is Pacifidlog Town. In the game, Pacifidlog Town is a town that takes place on the ocean where all the houses are on rafts. Well, in this course, some of the houses on rafts are actually obstacles that you'll have to avoid. You'll even see certain water-type Pokemon hanging around. I really dig how this one came out. Something about the popsicle stick rafts and the actual houses themselves, I don't know, it just looks really nice. This was always one of my favorite towns too. Like, as a kid, like, what is cooler than a bunch of, you know, houses on the water? I don't know, I always kind of loved Pacifidlog Town, and hey, with Mario Kart 7, 8, and 8 Deluxe, you can actually drive your kart underwater. Obviously, since that appears in Mario Kart Tour, no reason to believe they wouldn't do that for future Mario Karts, so this would actually work really well from a gameplay perspective as well. Next up, we have Fortree City, and man, out of all the cities, I think this one was definitely the coolest. In Gen 3, Fortree City is essentially a treehouse city. A full city in the trees is absolutely sick, and you run from house to house via these bridges across the treetops. I remember playing this on my Game Boy Advance SP that you saw earlier, and even though obviously it was all, you know, 16-bit graphics, when playing this all those years ago, my imagination would always run wild. Like, imagine an entire city full of tree houses. That's like a kid's dream. That's so cool. For this one, we just covered the ground in the pixel art of the trees, and used the same kind of raft system as before with Pacifidlog Town to get that same effect. For the final lap, this is absolutely the coolest lap in my opinion. This is Sootopolis City. Sootopolis City is a super vertical locale in Hoenn. All these houses are up up on cliffs and stuff, and there's valleys, and it's just super cool. On top of that, it's accompanied by this like white sheetrock sort of thing that I don't really think shows up that much anywhere else in Hoenn, so it's super cool and makes the city feel really unique. On top of that, the actual sprite for these houses are really cool. Actually recreating this one was super fun. Also, all-time goated starter Torchic is up on the mountaintops watching over you. If I'm being honest, this was by far the most fun one to make. It's the one we, you know, did the most with, and I think it's probably the best overall result out of the courses we'll show you today. As I said before, I'm so passionate about Gen 3, so actually just trying to do like any sorts of arts and crafts thing with Gen 3 and making it in real life, it was just super cool. Also, obviously, there's only so much me and my little sister can do with, you know, the paper and limited resources we have. On top of that, we had to work within the confines of the Mario Kart Live Home Circuit game, which is pretty limited, all things considered. So maybe one day I'll work with some 3D artists and actually make like a full diorama mock-up of what I think a Hoenn track could be. Because gameplay-wise, this could be by far one of the coolest tracks ever. Like, imagine gliding up to Fortree City and then swimming through Pacific Log Town. I mean, there's just so much opportunity for cool stuff here. Let's move on to the next track, and this one is a Winter Wonderland. I'm gonna be honest, I don't think there are that many good snow-themed courses in Mario Kart. There are some, don't get me wrong, but a lot of snow-themed courses just kinda come off as forgettable for me. Stuff like Rosalina's Ice World or Ice Ice Outpost, I don't know, is that a hot take? I just think the majority of snow-themed Mario Kart tracks are relatively forgettable. I guess it would be a cold take then, cause snow, I don't know. So basically, using our very limited resources, we tried to make the coolest holiday slash snow themed track we could. You'll see lots of Christmas bows, snowflakes, mistletoes, and whatnot. We even have these like cotton indoor snowball things. I don't even know where I got them. We've had them in our basement like forever, so we used those as like obstacles in the track, and I think it came out pretty well. I just think Nintendo really has kind of been lacking on the ice tracks as of late. There's only a few I can remember that are like really, really good. Like DK Summit is unbelievably fun. Mario Kart 9, I'm definitely looking forward to see what the inevitable, you know, ice or snow or holiday theme track is, and hopefully Nintendo can redeem themselves. Okay, last but not least, this track takes a bit of, you know, I need to explain this a little bit. On Mario Kart Double Dash, there was a track where you could race on a GameCube. This was a battle track, so I guess it was, you know, more battling on a GameCube rather than racing, but this battle track came back, I guess, spiritually in Mario Kart DS, but this time, obviously, you were racing on a DS. I've always thought the idea of these more meta Mario Kart tracks are super duper cool, but they've always been battle courses and never actual tracks. I think that Nintendo should do a sort of Nintendo Museum as one of the tracks in the next Mario Kart. I don't know, I just think this is absolutely sick. For this specific one that me and my sister made, we made it more so a showcase of Nintendo's portable history just because we have more of the portable consoles and, you know, we don't have all the old retro, like, home consoles. So the first lap of this track is dedicated to the Game Boy. You can see, once again, my trusty silver Game Boy Advance SP, I love that thing, coupled with some Pokemon because, I mean, you can't do a track history of Nintendo's, you know, handheld entries and not do like Pokemon. Like, Pokemon is Nintendo handheld. That's like what people think of. On top of that, though, here are some of the best Game Boy games that I have. For some reason, this Over the Hedge Game Boy Advance game is probably the best licensed game I've ever played. You'll see more licensed games coming up later on because, you know, when I was younger, I didn't have the money to buy the full Nintendo game, so I would buy like whatever was in clearance, and normally that was licensed games. But this Over the Hedge game, I don't know if it was just nostalgia or whatever, but it was super fun, and I played it recently, and for the most part, it held up. Let me know if you've ever played Over the Hedge for the Game Boy Advance. Super obscure thing. Maybe I should do an underviewed episode about it. Anyway, moving on from lap 1, we have lap 2, all about the original Nintendo DS. Once again, here's some more licensed games, including Lego Ninja something, I don't know. And then like Lego Battles, I don't know, I was super into Lego, so I mean, I guess that checks out. Also, this Tom and Jerry game, I'm pretty sure this sucked. I think this is the opposite of Over the Hedge. This was just not fun at all. However, this Phineas and Ferb game I think was pretty cool. It was like a really typical 3D platformer. Actually, now that I think about it, it was really linear and it had a focus on collectibles, and it kind of reminds me of a weird 3D world in a way. Maybe I should take a look at that. That could be a future video too, because that would be really funny. Anyway, moving on to lap 3, we have the 3DS, and this is where you start seeing all, you know, a ton of Nintendo boxes, because at this point I was actually buying my own games. I wasn't reselling them back to GameStop so I could buy newer games, and I was, you know, actually keeping the boxes and, you know, taking better care because I was actually buying these things. Obviously, it's essentially dead now, but the 3DS, man, the library of the 3DS I think is unmatched and is, I would have to say, by far and away the best Nintendo handheld library of all time. Last but not least, we're moving on into the Nintendo Switch, with both the Nintendo Switch Lite and the Nintendo Switch itself. I personally think of the Switch as more so a home console, but I can't deny that, I mean, the console itself is handheld. You just plug it into the TV to make make it a home console, so because of that, it obviously had to be on this track. And that wraps up this course. I mean, there's honestly so much they could do with, like, this Nintendo Museum sort of idea. Obviously, I took it in the handheld direction, but they could do home console, they could do, you know, History of Mario. That would be sick. Imagine you're, you know, driving through 1-1, like, the NES graphical style, and then you hop into, like, Bomb Bomb Battlefield, and then Super Mario 3D World, and or Mario Galaxy before that. I mean, you can't skip out on, like, Mario Galaxy. I think this is a great idea, but I don't know, that's just me. With that out of the way, those are the three courses that we made. I gotta thank my sister Nora, because this was an absolute blast to do with her. It was just, you know, a fun little project we did, and then I was like, hey, I might as well turn this into a video, so here we are. On top of that, thank you Skyforge once again for sponsoring this video. Longtime viewers of the channel will know I don't really do sponsorships ever, but I'm probably gonna start doing them more often now. I'm going to college next year, and as I'm sure everyone knows, that is just, you know, not cheap. So brand deals like that seriously help out the channel, and your guys' support just means the world on that sort of thing. With that out of the way, thank you guys all so much for watching. I'm Thomas on the Switch Stop, signing off. Peace.